Right. Can everybody hear me okay? All right, good. I'm David Goode with Piedmont Hops, and we're going to do a trellis presentation about just simple construction. I'm not going to get any details about weight-bearing loads and mathematics. It's just going to be the three different types of systems that we see typically for small-scale growers. So they're all unique in their own ways. You've got big grid systems, you've got low trellis systems, you've got inline rows, and you've got the TP-style systems as well, and we'll go over all of those. They all have their pros and cons. So TP system is just going to be a single pole with a ring of hops around it. You have the inline row, which is a row of poles. You saw, if you came out to my yard, I've got one system that's an inline and the other one is a grid system. And the grid is just a field of poles with interconnecting cables. So this is your TP style here. You'll have your hops, again, will be around the edges of that pole, and they'll grow up to the center. Here's some photos out of North Carolina, and you can see a clear ring of the hops, and they're all growing to the center of the pole. And it's a great system for a small scale or just testing a few varieties out. So what you'll need for this system, it's very simple. One pole, 16 to 20 feet. You're going to need a gas auger or some sort of handheld post hole digger, a tamp bar, a large eye bolt for the top, and a level and measuring tape. And it's very easy to put together with just one person. Can you step back a little bit? Can you see? Can we move everything to the side?
Maybe just back the closer gap.
Is that good?
Yep.
Okay. So the pros for the TP style, they're easy to install, they're inexpensive, and it's a one to two person job. Some of the cons are you're going to want to just grow one variety. If you put two and they start growing to the top, you're really not going to know what you're harvesting at that time. Weed control can be an issue. You've got to get inside those crowns and beyond that ring. That can be some sort of an issue. You're going to get reduced airflow, and airflow is very important in growing hops. And you got to get creative with your irrigation system. You got maybe some sort of soaker hose would be your best option for that. And why choose the TP style? It's ideal for new growers wanting just to try hops on their farm. If you've got, for instance, we've got a blueberry operation and we wanted to add maybe hops just to see how they did, this would be a great opportunity just to grow a few hops. Maybe if you're just a hobby grower in your backyard, this is another great trellis system. Small budgets, very cheap to put together. It's great if you have limited space. And it's excellent for a larger farm if you want to trial it, just a very unique variety just to see how it does. And these are some of the different TP systems you'll see. This one has eye bolts around the top. And so the coconut core twine goes up and down, back down to the base of the crown. This one's kind of unique. The photo's cut off, but the holes on the bottom are where the twine will go, and this whole system can lower down. So that's kind of unique. You can get in there and you can, if you have to spray for any diseases or issues you have, it's easy to do. It's easy to harvest and you raise it right back up. That's a kind of a unique system there. So now we're gonna get into the bigger trellis systems. And some of your initial thoughts, these are thoughts you really don't want to have when you're building your, when you're constructing. Poles are expensive, you want to space them out. You do want to space them out, but if you go too large and too wide, you can put a lot of stress on that system. So you want to keep them as tight as possible. And we do a spacing of, on our inline row, they're about 40 feet apart. And on our grid system, they're 40 by 27, I believe. Thinner wire is cheaper per foot. Let's use that. Not a good idea. You can put a lot of stress on that cable. You don't like heights? Let's grow short. It's okay to grow, do a short trellis. You'll still harvest, but the higher your trellis system, the better your yields are going to be. Let's grow an extra foot by only going 2 feet deep. And what I mean by that is putting that full pole 2 feet in the ground. That's not a good idea. You need to be, we have ours at least 40 inches. 48 is a good measure too. And this looks fun. It is and it isn't. We have a lot of fun with what we do. If it wasn't fun, we really wouldn't do it, but there's a lot of hard work to be involved. and here, hold my beer. That's the last thing you want to do. Do that at the end of the day after you build your trellis system. And these poplar poles, gum trees, there's certain types of woods you want to use. And we use cedar from our forest. If you have a nice property that has cedar, you want to use them from deep within the woods. They're going to have more heart. If you use field cedar, there's not much heart and they won't last very long. They end up fracturing rather quickly. This is our inline system in Virginia. You can see it's a single row of poles. On the left-hand side is our Cascade row. The next row over to the right is Chinook, and then we have Nugget. You can't see that row, but it's just a single row of poles and a row of cable. Those are about 40 feet apart down the row. And our rows are 11 feet apart. We basically built it off of an old blueberry field. So those rows are already there. This is at the top of our trellis. You can see the eye bolt and the cable running down. This is at the beginning of the season before anything has really broken ground. Actually, it has because we've already strung, so we're getting ready to train there. This is our inline in North Carolina. It's hard to see in this photo, but I'll point it out and I'll step back to the mic. Right here. Is there, might be a laser on here. No. That's a row of poles, but the actual hops are on the outside of the poles, so they grow together. So it's almost like an inline and a teepee all in one. So we've maximized that space with our Cascade. It does all right, but the weed control in between the two and the pole, it gets kind of difficult. We have to go in there with the weed eater and the push mower instead of the lawn tractor, so it's a little bit more difficult. Oh, there's the shot. I should have just gone to that one. You can see there's the pole and then the hops on the outside edge. And you want to do the same variety if you're going to do that. It needs to be both Cascade or both Chinook or whatever you choose to grow. So the basics of what you'll need for an inline, 16 to 22 foot poles, because you're going to put those things 4 feet down. If you go 4 feet on a 16, you're looking at a 12 foot. That's roughly a low trellis system. The auger, the tamp bar, and your galvanized braided wire, three sixteenths, or even larger. 3/16 is kind of small. You'll need the cable clamps. I've got all this stuff up here, and afterwards, if y'all want to check some of this stuff out, y'all can look at that as well. You're going to need large anchors, because once you go long on these inline rows, it does get heavy at the end, and you'll need some sort of support there, and large eye bolts at the top of the trellis system as well. Your turnbuckles, we use a large turnbuckle at the end of our rows on the larger trellis. On our inline, we don't use the turnbuckle. Our inline is designed to lower, so we use the heavy-duty ratchet tie-downs, which are rated over several thousand pounds at breaking strength, so they work just fine. We'll unloosen that ratchet, that whole system lowers down. It's great for hand-picking or if you're setting up to do a pick-your-own trellis system. You'll need various wrenches and tools and beers and friends. Putting up an inline, there's a lot more involved. You'll need to be on ladders, you'll need tractors, you'll need equipment, you'll need people watching, people taking care of things, and people prepping. So get some people together to help you out. Here we are prepping our poles. We pre-drill at the top of our cedar to insert that eye bolt. I love the smell of cedar when we're working with it. And there's the eye bolt sunk in. This is our antique auger. I don't think it has any more seasons left in it. We'll push it to the limits, but we use that. That'll get us down to about 3 feet, and then we'll clean out the rest by hand. We do a lot of work by hand. As you can see, we raise our poles by hand. It's a lot of hard work, but that's how we do it. It's actually the safest way for us. We've tried various methods with a tractor and a chain and the front end loader, and it just doesn't seem that safe. That is a 20-foot pole, 40 inches in. That's a pretty good perspective.
What diameter is the hole?
I believe it is a foot. Maybe it's a 10 inch or 12. I can't remember.
How heavy is a pole like that?
How heavy? Who asked that question? It's too heavy. It's very heavy. It's
How many people do you need to do it?
Well, my brother is he's a very large dude. Yeah. He's very strong, so he comes on and helps quite a bit. It usually takes two of us. We've got a couple videos that we've done, and one of the poles, it was hard to get up. And so a couple times we finally got it up there, and sometimes we'll dig a little ditch at the front end to get that angle going and put some boards on the back side of the hole so there's no dirt being filled in as it's pushing against the back side of the hole. and that's our field of poles. After a day of work, they're crooked. We haven't tamped them in or set them yet. And those are all cedar. This is the, if you came out to our yard yesterday, this is the one that was further out in the field, and that's not what it looks like anymore. So we've basically removed row 2 and 3 and skipped some rows, and we developed a grid system. So we removed our inline system and created a grid system later on. We just felt like we wanted to expand. That was the best option for us, is to go for a larger trellis system. So here's an inline row with the pulley system. You can see at the bottom photo, the crank and the pulleys up at the top. So that system does lower as well for hand picking and raising back up. Sometimes cascade, if you hand pick cascade, it will flower again late in the season. You can pick again. If that's the case and you do that, you want to send those things off for analysis to make sure that that second harvest is not a subpar harvest. These guys went from a lower trellis system and raised their system up. That's a very tall ladder. What we do when we have a ladder leaning up against the pole, we'll take the front end loader of our tractor and push it up against the other side of the pole, just for safety reasons. But they had you can see on the left, some more of a lower trellis system, and they raised up. Blue Ridge Hops is now, they no longer grow hops, but this was what their last expansion they grew, went up for a higher yield. This is Justin Dick at Kelly Ridge Farm. He's got a beautiful hedgerow of hops here on his inline system. Nice, clean, neat rows. He's got it nicely weeded on the edges. Easily takes care of that field, and he grows some quality hops there. There's his system on the left, pre-harvest, when it's just starting to grow. And there's his system on the right. He's got a beautiful setup. Nice touch with the flag. So pros and cons of the inline. It's got great airflow. These are going to be the pros. You can be creative with them. Like I've said, you can lower these systems so you can do the hand picking, and you can set up for pick your own. We've talked to some local homebrew clubs in Richmond, and we've decided that the our front yard, since we can lower it, there's no really insurance that we're going to need. There's no ladders. There's no heavy equipment. We can lower that system, have them go out and pick per pound. So we're going to look into doing that next year. We were going to do it in 2015, but our crop was a low yield, and we had to tap into that field. Yes, sir. Recommend on the distance if you do the inline. We do 11 feet. That's where it was. Our rows were already established, but you can go up to 13 and space your plants out 3.5 feet in the 13-foot row. Basically, whatever equipment you have on hand that can get down your rows, kind of base it off of what you have. You don't want to go too wide and waste that opportunity to grow, but you don't want to go too narrow and not get that airflow. So I wouldn't go under 10 feet between rows for the airflow purposes. And some of the cons, it's costly. Now you got more cable, more poles, more land. You're going to need more people and more equipment, and they're dangerous to construct. Again, this is ideal for limited spaces. If you have a small section of your farm and you want to just add a little bit of value to it, you can do 4 poles of hops 40 feet apart, and you can get a nice little crop out of that. And maybe you just want to stay small, so you don't really want to expand. You can go do a few rows of the inline and just be done with it. And the flip side of that is you can slowly build off it. You can add another row of hops next to it. You can do multiple varieties on one row. You just need to space out that second variety at least 7 to 10 feet. So you could grow 30 cascade at 3.5 feet apart, and then space out another 10 feet and do another variety. Lowering capabilities are important. Maybe you don't like the heights, and maybe that's part of what you want to do. It's a little bit easier to construct than a grid system. So this is our grid system. So the original photo I showed you of the 4 rows, you can see where we've removed the poles and spaced them out. That pole there, we left. I cut it at a wrong spot by accident. It actually has a knot that you can sit on. So it's a nice little bench, so we just left it there. Serves no purpose, but just to sit. And our rows from the far right to the left are Nugget, Chinook, and then the rest are Cascade, and then the outside two rows on the, excuse me, from right to left, and the far left are CTZ. And so here you can see, looking down the row up at the top, you can see the cable that goes across, and then the cables that are resting on top. They're still loose. We haven't tightened everything up there. And it's important to have a really tight grid system. You don't want anything loose, because that thing, once the wind hits, it's a giant kite out there. So you want to make sure everything's nice and tight. And this is our top cable. Does anybody know what's wrong with this photo? Anybody? Nobody? Well, no, we wrapped it. It is a lot. We probably don't need to wrap it as much, but we did because we had excess cable at the time, and cutting that off would have done us, that was the end of our line there, so we just wrapped it. But we did not, we did our cables, our clamps wrong. They're on backwards. Never saddle a dead horse. There you go. So there's your saddle. There's your U-bolt. And basically, you want to saddle your live, that wire where all the tension is. If it's the dead end, you don't want to saddle that. So there's a proper way. And at the bottom, you can see where you have the live end and the dead end and how they have it saddled properly. Excuse me? Okay. That's wrong. You can see where we've saddled the dead end. Dead end here, saddles, and then you clamp it on the other side. So we've gone up and fixed all those issues. And this is at Huguenot Hops. This is their grid system. And their poles are on the edge of their rows. We have our poles in our actual row of hops, but they have theirs. So in between their poles, they have three rows of hops. Versus ours, where we have two. And their trellis system is 21 feet tall, I believe, or 20 feet. Ours is 17. And there's theirs looking down. Who all attended the hop yard tours yesterday? Okay, good. So this is before they expanded more to the right. This is that lower field looking down towards their pond and the main road where you pull it up to. So is the vine growing straight up or is it they're going to grow straight up. That pole is just there to support the cable. Yep, there's a cable on the side, yes. Actually, the cable's on the top, and I believe it's kind of going to grow at a slight angle, but it's going to be relatively straight.
Does the grass in between the lines, does it matter what you have there? I mean, is there things you don't want to have in the middle or things you do?
We just have just grass. You can I think James is going to talk about some other things that you can put in the middle of the rows. We just have incorporated what's in our field. And I know Stan does some cover crops as well that you can put in the middle. You're just going to cut when you harvest, you're going to cut at the top. Well, you'll cut at the bottom, then cut at the top, and they fall into a trailer. So you're cutting everything down. No, they wrap around. You're going to hang string from the top of the cable down to the ground. And I've got some of that stuff with me today, too. Yeah, so here's a string here that they're stringing up to the top. This is at Whipple Creek Farm. It's a great shot. You can clearly see their grid system. You can see the old knots from, this, I guess, the season before. And they're stringing down, and one person's tying the knots, and it looks like someone else has got the hop clip applicator and is inserting that core twine into the ground.
Where the wires intersect, are they clamped or are they just loose?
They're loose, but you can clamp just so that they stay where they're supposed to. Like we have on our grid, we didn't clamp. We were putting stuff together late last year, and we ran out of time, and it slid. So we're going to go in and fix all that and clamp it so it doesn't move.
It seems like when the wind blows, the whole
it can move. But if your system is short enough, you probably can get away without clamping. But if it's a big, large system and you're going half acre field or something, you might want to clamp those down so they stay put.
So
And here's Whipple. He's got his poles in between the in the hop rows there. So he's got three rows between his poles. It looks like to me maybe it's a 16-foot pole several feet in the ground. Those look like they're 4x4 posts or a 4x6. So there's his production field right there. This is Celestial Hops. They use a 6x6 pole, a 5/16-inch guy wire, and a 1/8-inch stringing wire. So the guy wires are going to be your heavy-duty cables that's going to secure everything at the top, and then your stringing wire is what the wire that's going to go down that hovers over top of that row that you're going to tie your lines to. And these are 180-foot rows on an 8-foot plant, or 8-foot spacing and 3.5 feet apart on the plants. And they got a nice little drip irrigation system going too. Looks good. So the basics of what you'll need, just more cable, a lot more cable. Specialized tensioning tools, we use a Havens grip and a come along to pull everything tight. You're gonna need more clamps, larger corner anchors. You don't wanna go small in your corners because there's a lot of weight being pulled in there. You've got the weight of the cable, you got the weight of the hops, the wind's blowing. You've got a derecho coming through, hurricane season. It can be scary out there, so you want to make sure everything is secured and anchored. And anything else that you've used in the inline system, you're going to use for this as well. We have some types of cable. Some sizes are 3/16, 1/4, 3/8, and on, and larger. There's different braids, 1x7, a 7x7, and a 7x19. Some of the finishes are galvanized, steel, or coated. But what you're looking for is galvanized. You don't want any of the coating or the steel. The coating will wear off, it's going to rust, the steel's going to rust, but the galvanized is the way to go for your cable system. So to explain what a braid is, this is a 7x19, is what we use. It's easy to work with and it's very flexible. It's seven large braids made up of 19 tiny braids to make up one cable. And so a 7x7 would be seven small cables braided into seven to make one cable. A little bit more stiff. This is just a photo of some of the cable, you know, rolls of cable, how you'll get them on a big spool. We buy ours online several thousand feet at a time. Shipment of cables and hop grip applicators. These are handy tools once you go into stringing. Your string's hanging down, you take your W-clip and you stomp that string in and it stays nice and tight in the ground, it doesn't pull up, and then you'll strain your plants around that. Your thimbles and cable clamps, you'll need a lot of these, a whole bunch, so I would suggest order those in bulk. Anytime you can save 2 cents, 3 cents, 5 cents on something, because ordering more, go ahead and do it. You'll save yourself a lot of money in the long run, and you'll have extras too on hand when you need them. So here's a loop ends for the turnbuckles. Again, we kind of already gone on over this with the saddle, the dead end, and the live end. But you're going to need three clamps on your ends there. That's really going to make that nice and secure and tight. My anchor got in the way of the bigger the better. But we use the 40x4-inch. And I think we got those. I don't know why that anchor's turned that way. But they were about $5.40-something a piece online, and there's a 48x6. We don't have the equipment to put these in, so we have to put them in by hand. It's a lot of hard work to put a metal pipe in there and turn that thing down on the ground. So a 40x4 works for us, and it's nice and tight in our soil. If you have a little bit more sand, you want to go with a larger, deeper anchor.
How long are your rows?
Our rows are, let's see, we have 180 feet long, I think. Some of the turnbuckles we use. Another item you want to order in bulk and have extras on hand. You don't want to have something fracture and you don't have that extra on hand. So always order something more than what you need. You'll thank yourself in the end. We haven't had anything fracture yet, but when we do, I've got a couple of these in the shed that I can go grab. And this is your Havens grip. You're going to put the jaw part on the top cable, connect a come along to that, to one of the poles, and start pulling down. Get that thing nice and tight, and you can put your clamps on, and it's gonna stay steady that way. You won't be able to make a grid system without some sort of tool like this to pull it tight. You can't do it by hand. It's not going to work. That's just a come along that you would use to help crank all that cable tight. Some of the pros and cons of the big grid system. You're going to use less poles per acre. If you did a whole acre with the inline row, you know, you're going to use a lot more poles. You're going to get more airflow. You can get heavy equipment to maneuver in there because there's less poles. So in the off season, if you have the irrigation out of the way, you can kind of drive in there and do some stuff. Increase in yields because of that airflow, that's going to be helpful. Some of the cons, costly, about $6,000 per acre for the trellis. That's when you're buying the poles. We haven't had to buy any poles. We source all of ours on our property, so we've come in a lot lower than that. And that cost doesn't include the irrigation and the plants or the rhizomes or any other equipment you want out there. Some people use cloth to help with the weed control. We started doing that, but we've pulled all that up. You'll need more cable, so that's a cost, and more specialized equipment, and just more overall parts and maintenance. And I've mentioned that before. You want to have all these extra parts on hand if something were to fracture on you. So why choose? It's the industry standard. Yes, sir?
Why did you pull your cloth up?
It was harboring weeds. Basically, the dirt was staying on top of the cloth, and those weeds would stay there. So after the first year, it looked great, and it was really pretty. But over the time, the weeds started just to stay there, and so we're just going to pull it up. And then we can till around the edges. Yes?
Did you substitute paper for cloth and dry it?
Would I do what?
Did you substitute paper for cloth and dry it?
Paper for cloth. No, well, what we do is I'll get off a little off topic, but I'll jump back in. We bring in leaves and we set up our own compost. We make our own compost that goes around the hill. And then during the fall, we have a straw maize. And after the straw maize season is over, they've gotten wet and saturated and they start to compost. And those things can come apart in sheets, and we'll lay those down on the edges of the rows, and that helps suppress the weeds a lot. And we'll also take the hand tiller and just walk down the side, and it helps control those weeds some. The grid system is going to be, you need to be accessible with specialized equipment for pesticides, stringing, and harvesting. One of the things with the grid is you're going to build it and be done. You really don't want to expand off. Once it's there, you can expand, but ideally you're going to want to build this thing and just let it be. So which is right for you? That's the biggest question. That's a photo I found online the other day. That's how they did it. They used stilts. What are your financial capabilities? What can you afford? What can you afford to lose? That's another thing to think about. How much land do you want to dedicate to your hops? A little bit you want to do, that maybe the inline or the teepee, but if you have a full acre, then maybe you want to go to that grid system. And what's your business plan set up for? Are you set up to expand? Are you set up to stay where you are? And that's another thing to consider. What kind of equipment do you have on hand? And what are your comfort levels? Obviously, this guy is very comfortable on the stilts. He's got his children watching. I would not do that. Yeah, maybe. So short trellis, you're going to decrease your yields a little bit. I was talking to Ann George a little bit ago. They're still getting good yields on any short trellis, so it's not a bad idea to do short, especially if you're not into the big heights. You can go as low as maybe 10 feet would be an ideal for short trellis, maybe 12. So there's no tall equipment. You can easily have a stepladder and do the work you need to do there. And those are very easy to install and maintain. I mean, a short trellis, those poles are, you know, you could put those up by yourself without the help of equipment or other people. So it's not ideal for a high cone set variety. A lot of the hops, all your hops are going to be harvested way up high. But a variety like Chinook, what we see is those cones set up real high on the vine. So a short trellis may not be ideal for that. I don't have the research on that because we don't grow a short trellis, but our experience is those cones are way up high, so a shorter trellis may not be ideal for that. So in conclusion, it's a big undertaking and it requires a lot of planning and design work. You want to sit down, you don't want to just go out and start digging holes and going cutting poles. You really think this thing out. And the amount of time, the amount of finances are going to play a big role in how successful that system is. If you skimp out, it may fail. If you put in extra money, it's going to survive. and do your research on what you want to do and how you want to, how your end product wants to be. And like I said, never cut corners. It's just not worth it at the end. Again, just a small disclaimer, I'm not an expert. This is a simple educational discussion. So if we have any questions, feel free to ask. I'll do the best I can to answer. I don't know a lot about load bearing and that kind of mathematical stuff. James may be able to go over some of that later today. Some of my resources, Simple Earth Hops, Great Lakes Hops, Michigan State University, ODHC, Huguenot, NC State, Whipple Creek, and Kelly Ridge Farm. And now we've got Virginia Tech on board, which was the Cooperative Extension Service. When I did this presentation last year, you did not have the trellis system up. And so we've got a great research here going on in Virginia. So we're really excited about that and at Virginia State University. So any questions? Yes, in the back.
Have I ever heard anyone speak about how when you load up these cables and you end up with curtains of hops? Every 3 feet apart or so, 6 feet apart, you have a net of 10, 12, 5, half. The orientation with the sun, whether it's from north and south, if I have the opportunity to choose, or east and west, I'd love the sun to hit these curtains.
Yeah, ideally you don't want your varieties to shade on the row. So for us, we grew hops in two different directions, and not that we can see. The original yard we built too close to the woods, and the morning shade hits, and that's where we're going to have disease issues, and we're probably going to end up ripping up that original yard and moving it. Yes. I'm not exactly sure. I really don't. Do you know an answer to the?
I have heard
southern. Sorry, there's a lot of folks. But do you run them down or across on a southern?
I don't know. I don't know that answer. I have no slopes.
We don't have as big. It's like a greenhouse production. We don't have as big an issue. So yeah. Orienting it so it's east to west is. Works fine.
Yeah, that's yeah, you don't want major wind. Yeah, that's I mean, wind is good for the airflow, but if it's a heavy wind coming straight across the field, that can be if it hits it, you know, T-bones that trellis system, it could do some damage. Yeah. Yeah, as much sun as you can get on those things. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
We ran ours north and south, and we wound up with great exposure to sun. We're up downhill slope of the outside of the hill. The airflow isn't an issue. And that's another reason we chose the slope that's good to see from the south. But we've got solar collections on the property.
North and south. Yeah. Okay.
I missed the last part. You said
north and south. Your rows are going north and south.
The rows are planted.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Questions? Yes. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. My question is,
The difference in yields from the inline versus the grid system?
Yes.
Yes. In the inline, what we've done is with a grid system, if you use two strings, well, we use one, but on other fields with the grid system, you can use two strings and V those plants, and that'll give you a great increase in airflow. And you've got two strings for a higher yield. With inline, you're going to have one string, but if you V down your row, they're going to start getting clumped together, and you can come up with disease issues, which are going to decrease your yield. But we've moved to one string on the inline, and actually we're going to do one string on our grid. But I do think, from what I've seen from other farms, that an inline will have a smaller yield versus that grid system, because you can space them out a little bit better. Yes?
Is this something you could ask for email?
Can this presentation be emailed? I believe it's on the Cooperative Extension website.
It's on the Virginia Cooperative Extension. Don't you have some videos on your website too? Are y'all putting it up?
There may be videos. Do we have time for? They're just silly videos, really.
We have 5 minutes. I see a video.
I mean, they're on the file somewhere. How do you get?
I don't know how to do that.
Huh?
Oh, I don't know.
Never mind.
I'm like,
can I
specify your roads? Your roads are 180 feet.
Do you know anything about roads longer than that? Is there a problem going longer than 180 feet?
No, you're just going to need bigger anchors. Yeah, thicker cable, bigger anchors. It's the bigger you get, the heavier everything's
going to
be. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Have you seen a difference yet? I think you said your poles are at like 17 feet, even at farms.
The question is there a difference between a 17-foot and a 20-foot trellis as far as production? The higher you go, the more plant material you're going to have, so the more opportunity to have hop cones. We're still young in the industry. I can't really compare with Huguenot quite yet. They've been in this for 4 years and we've been in it for five, so there's not enough, and we've always expanded and so have they, so we have all these mature, immature, and very young plants, so I don't have that data to share, but I would say that a little bit taller is better. We just went with 17 feet because that was our safety. Yes?
What size twine do you use versus
what kind of twine? When we first started, we used an untreated sisal, and it would rot. So then we did a ground cable and tied to the upper end to the lower and then trained that way, and that was a hassle. So now we just use the coconut core, which comes in big bales. Most of them are pre-cut to about 20 to 21 and a half feet. They come in hanks of 200 strings, and I believe a bale is probably made up of maybe 16 hanks. Or more, and you'll soak that in water overnight. It loosens it up, and it's easy to work with, and that they won't break on the ground. And I've got a sample of that twine here. Yes.
How about
fencing for deer or other wildlife? We have no issues with deer. The only time we've had any issues with deer is when we planted fresh hops in the fall. We had a doe out there that would pull up the plants, but they're very coarse. The vine itself, if you look at it very closely, it's almost got thorns on it in a sense, and they just don't like it. So there's no issues there. Huguenot hops had deer come in, and they actually defoliated the lower 4 feet just like a sheep would. So they can be beneficial. So don't fence off. Yeah, you'll be fine. Yes, front.
So like chickens, free-range chickens and stuff?
Free-range chickens? I don't know much about that. I can't imagine chickens would do anything. That might do
make
some good.
Make sure your plants are established before you let the chickens in. Chickens are little bulldozers. I can speak to those.
Okay. So there you go. Okay. Yes, sir. Different irrigations for the different trellis systems. The only difference would be if you used the TP style, you're going to have a ring of irrigation. You don't want to use any sort of overhead or any sort of sprinkler because you're going to keep those leaves wet, and that's just going to ask for downy mildew issues or any other diseases. You want those leaves to stay nice and dry. We used what we had on hand at the farm, which was standard T-tape, and it's not doing a good enough job for us. It keeps it wet, but it's not really feeding those roots the way we want to. But there's really, between an inline and a grid system, whatever sort of irrigation you want to use will work just fine. You're going to use a standard row of tape or tubing. Some people use emitters. Some people use them with the built-in emitters. It's just whatever you're comfortable with using. Again, if you use emitters that you have to insert, make sure you have some on hand in case you get clogged or you need to replace them. Maybe any more time? Are we good? Any more questions? Yes, sir, in the back. Are there, what was the question again?
Poles.
So with the poles we use, they're cedar, they're natural, so there's no, they're not treated with any sort of chemicals. So we aren't certified organic, but we do everything we can to be as organic as possible. You can use treated poles. There's also black locust. There's larch. There's a product called, what is the wrap that goes around the pole? That's I can't think of it now. But there's a wrap that can go around some of the poles so it keeps that ground level from rotting, and that's where all your rot's going to occur. Rot block. There you go. That's the name of the product. I think they're out in the Pacific Northwest, but they ship out here as well, and that's a good product. We don't use that, but we probably should have when we started. So, yes.
What's the main challenge keeping you from being certified organic?
The main challenge to being certified organic is there's no need or there's no market right now. There's no brewers that are really focused on in our area that are doing organic. So as far as the certification goes, it's really not a marketing point for us. We pretty much tell people that we grow responsibly, and that's how we market our product. Good?
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you, David. This is great. How many of y'all are thinking? Woo-hoo. And he's got a bunch of fun stuff up here if you want to look at some earth anchors and the clip applicator and some cable. How many of y'all have yet to build? Like, you're here going, I'm thinking about it. How many of y'all already have poles in the ground? All right. This is interesting, and we just built our yard at Virginia Tech, and yes, I wanted answers. I wanted to know what do we need, 18 or 19 or 20 feet? What's the answer? There's not one, and it's what you got and what you can get your hands on and what your equipment will fit down the row, and which is all kind of a little too qualitative for me. I like quantitative. I want to know why. So, but we're working. To get more information like that online, we've got Chip Clark, who's an architect and engineer at Virginia Tech, doing some actual really good diagrams. There's also info out there from some of the companies that David showed you. If you go to usahops.org, they have a whole list of resources. And a lot of these cabling companies and all the earth anchors, mil-spec, some are on the West Coast, some are in, around Pennsylvania and all that. So there's lots of resources and links you can click on. Also, the Virginia Cooperative Extension HOPS website has some great resources. And we'll make sure this talk gets posted to that. And Jeanine's also going to have all of this. As you see, it's being filmed, so you can have this for a resource. Jeanine also has all of last year's speakers at this conference that we had in Winston-Salem. So it's all out there for you. You have to look a little bit. But there are no answers. Everybody's new at this. And I really appreciate David sharing his knowledge. So, yes.